Okay, we are now recording. I would like to take the opportunity to welcome everybody to tonight's public input session for the Greenleaf Lafayette Road intersection. This intersection, as everybody knows, is a challenging intersection from a safety standpoint, and it's something that the Parking, Traffic, and Safety Committee voted on to look at doing upgrades to a couple of years ago. Dependent upon the completion of the improvements at Andrew Jarvis intersection, which has been done. And so we are now at a point where we'd like to turn to get input from everybody. And before we start that though, Eric Eby has a couple slides and he'll kind of go over the existing conditions. You know, at this point, we are really just gathering information. We have no set design. We have no, you know, we're not married to anything. We don't have a designer on board yet. So with this input, it'll help us focus the scope of work for the designer we do hire, and then there'll be public process as part of that design process. And so really, this is really the first opportunity to have input, and we will have additional input as we move forward with the design once we've selected a new designer. So with that, Eric, why don't you have your presentation?
Okay, thank you, Peter. I'll bring up a few slides on my screen. So this is the, if everyone can see this, this is the overall picture of the intersection. And you're all familiar with Greenleaf Ave. It comes in this acute angle onto Lafayette Road. And in recent years, we've installed a bike lane on each side here of the roadway. So it changed the striping out here. We have added a crosswalk at this location because this crosswalk, the sidewalk used to come up and end with nowhere to go for pedestrians. The angle of the intersection is very challenging, as well as the hill in Lafayette Road here, which limits sight lines coming down. And the alignment of the roadway from Lafayette is almost a straight shot for cars coming off of Lafayette and shooting down Greenleaf Ave. So they tend to take this at a high rate of speed. And then there's a curve down as you approach Hillside, which is, makes it very challenging to get out of Hillside as cars come around that blind corner at a high rate of speed. So as part of the bike lane project, we did add some striping and some flex post bollards out in this area, which helps to sharpen that turn a little bit and slow the vehicles as they come into Greenleaf Ave. And also the striping for the bike lane itself, these green blocks, it helps to lessen the visibility or lessen the impact area of the conflict between the bicycles and pedestrians in this intersection, because it is a very wide intersection. You go from this point up here down to here, you're looking at over 100 feet and just a very difficult intersection, a lot of pavement to traverse. So it's always been challenging. And I have another slide to show the area in general. So this shows the bypass here on the left, Andrew Jarvis to the high school on the right, and Lafayette Road down where it meets the bypass. So about, I'd say it was 10, 15 years ago, this interchange down here was reconfigured to go from the flyover to a full traffic signal. And what that has done is allow all the movement to and from Lafayette and the bypass to be made at this location. Whereas before, half the movements were made here and the other half had to use Greenleaf in order to get between Lafayette and the bypass. So now with this interchange intersection improvement down here, there really is not a need to have this intersection up here at Greenleaf and Lafayette, and it gives us the opportunity to make some safety improvements and some modifications to it. Also, in recent years, we added the signal at the intersection of the high school and Lafayette Road, and this has made it much easier to get out of the high school and take a left and come down here to the bypass. Previously, it was much easier to take a right turn out of Andrew Jarvis, and then a lot of vehicles would take the left onto Greenleaf because it was to make. So with that, you know, we're looking at what movements could be possibly be modified or restricted to improve the safety here. So the vehicles that are coming out of Greenleaf Ave onto Lafayette have a really tough sight line looking to traffic coming from the downtown area. You know, and it is possible that if we were to make this, say, a one-way street coming from the Lafayette down to the bypass, that this traffic that currently makes a left and comes up Greenleaf could continue on the bypass and make a left at the signal down at Lafayette and come up that way. It would be much safer and you could accommodate that traffic down there. So and then likewise, traffic that's coming out of Andrew Jarvis making a right turn and then a left onto Greenleaf could instead make a left out of the school and take a right down at the bypass. those movements weren't available up until the reconfiguration of this intersection. So it's just some thoughts we have at this point is to, you know, how to improve the safety of this intersection, the sight lines. You really can't improve the sight lines, you know, dropping the hill down to where you could see over it would be a major undertaking. You'd have a significant grade change, retaining walls, utility relocation. So in order to address that safety issue, you really, you know, it may be more of an issue of reversing the flow and not allowing vehicles to come out at that intersection. But we want to get people's input on these ideas and to see what you think about this before we go ahead and bring a designer on board to take a closer look at this. Also, the speeds coming down the hill, you know, if we could tee off this intersection somewhat, like it is now with a post, although we could make that a more permanent change with bollards or something that would make this a curb line, a straight curb line. That would significantly slow the speeds as they come onto Greenleaf Ave. So these are some ideas we have. We wanted to share them with you and get some feedback from you. We also have, this is a picture looking from Hillside up towards Lafayette. And you can see, you know, the blind curve here on Greenleaf and the tree and the knoll. It's really challenging, especially the speed that vehicles are coming down here. We've had requests for crosswalks in the past at this location, but you know, just simply striping a crosswalk with these existing speeds is not a safe condition. So we really want to address, you know, both the speeds and the sight lines up at the hill. You know, one thought was possibly if this went to a one-way flow, that we could just narrow the roadway up to one lane and you could possibly add a sidewalk on this side of the street, you know, providing better pedestrian connections between the neighborhood and Lafayette. So these are, you know, some considerations we've been thinking of, but we want to get your input on this and see what, if any ideas you have. Because you live in the neighborhood, you live with this on a daily basis, living it, driving it, walking it. So your input is very valuable in this process. We'd like to hear from you on it. So I guess if there's anything else, Peter or Councillor, at this point we could take some public comments.
Yeah, I could just say that, you know, the city's been looking at this for 3 or 4 years, and we just want to make sure that, you know, if we do something, we do it with the residents' input. And, you know, those who live on Hillside Drive, I'm sure, have their own ideas. So we're going to be all ears here. There's nothing's set in stone. You know, we're going to take your input and figure out what are the next steps, if any. So anyway.
So I'll manage the hands up. I see a Greg Hebert. So.
Okay.
Greg, why don't you, I think you're on mute, Greg.
Okay, you got me from my ear now? Can you hear me now?
Yep,
okay.
We can.
All right, thanks guys for hosting this. I appreciate it. For all of us who live on Hillside Drive in this neighborhood, it's great to know that people are thinking about this and understand the safety concerns. I would say in my household on Hillside Drive, the general orientation is we want to keep Hillside Drive connected to Portsmouth as safely as possible. And Eric, thanks for kind of the detail and the history of what's happened, what you guys have looked at. I think the idea of having a one-way street going toward the bypass connects our neighborhood to the bypass versus connecting our neighborhood to Portsmouth. And so I would say for me, that's the opposite direction, that we would look at that and say, what is the safest way, if there's gonna be a one-way on Greenleaf, to connect Greenleaf to Lafayette? I am not a traffic expert. You know, is it stop lights, stop signs, small rotary there? I don't know what there's room for, but that to me would be the highest priority, is to keep this neighborhood connected going in that direction.
All right. Well, thank you, Greg.
Sure.
Bernice Brody.
Okay, can you hear me now?
We can.
Okay. Well, I agree with what Greg said, so thank you for his comments. But I have a question. So if it's one way from Lafayette towards the bypass, which I don't think we like, but if it were, how would you get onto that, get into Hillside from the bypass?
you would go down to the light at the Tuscan Kitchen or whatever it is now.
Yeah.
And turn left there at the light.
Yeah.
And then go up and then turn left onto
well, that's
onto Hillside.
Not a good answer.
That's just as dangerous.
Yeah, I don't like that.
Well, you need to have a left turn lane created. Mm-hmm. So this, you know, as we said, this is not designed.
And we're
putting ideas out there. The one way in the opposite direction towards Lafayette doesn't resolve the safety issue. The traffic signal would, if it's allowable by the state, could potentially be an option. But then you have two traffic lights very closely together. I should let you speak, Bernice.
No, thank you for your input. I just, I'm not a fan of going up and having to make that left-hand turn. And I know that this would, making that a right-hand turn only, like keeping it two-way, but only having a right-hand turn only help any of the safety concerns. Like not allowing a left onto Lafayette, only a right.
It would, but it's still a blind. Is still a difficult from a sight distance. But it's not as bad. But your input is awesome, and this is exactly the type of stuff we were hoping to flesh out.
Yeah,
I'm done. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Thank you, Bernice. Jacqueline Santiago.
Oh, did I click the wrong one?
Okay.
All right.
Am I unmuted now?
You are.
Hello, everybody. So I'm at 125 Greenleaf. So I am the house at the very bottom of the corner of the hill. So my husband and I are looking at the design and kind of looking at each other going, it needs to go the other way. So we agree with Gregory that the flow should go from Lafayette, top of the hill, down to Route 1 bypass, because we have cars coming from that bypass. The light turns green and they fly through here like it is a race car pit stop. It's like, boom, and they're gone. So as a safety issue, I think that it's the flow of traffic should go the other way down the hill, not up.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And there's a huge blind spot at the top of the hill. So you have traffic going up, you know, it's just, it makes it very, very dangerous.
Okay. Well, thank you for that comment.
Yes.
Allison Tanner. I think I might have just muted you, Allison. I'm sorry.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Hi. So my husband and I do exactly what you have suggested, Eric, in that I live down the other end of Greenleaf Avenue. And if we want to go up to Lafayette Road, we make a right out of Greenleaf where the dealership is, and then make a left going down Lafayette Road. However, I see the difficulty in we would need a left-hand turn lane, and I've all thought a long time about that triangular piece of property at the top of Greenleaf where it meets Lafayette. There's some lilacs planted there, and I was just wondering if we couldn't make it a right-hand turn there, or from coming from Lafayette, a left-hand turn directly into that street. You know what I mean? Like instead of making it that acute angle that you have. Yeah, you see the triangular piece of land that, mm-hmm. Yeah, to abut it, cut it off and make a real turn lane there so that it's easier to navigate if you do decide the one way going toward the bypass is the way you want to go, that if you want to make a left-hand turn, going around that triangular piece is very awkward. And if you could just access a segment of that to create a roadway that doesn't have an acute angle, I think that would help.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. I know we do have some property lines that end right about here. So we do have some land we can deal with without having to acquire easements or any properties. But yep, that's something we can consider.
But it's a good point, though. We may, you know, it's worth exploring to see if there's a way that we can shift that, slide that intersection down a little bit, square it up. Mm-hmm. And that way you get better sight distance over the hill at the same time. Thank you, Allison.
Welcome.
Seth Campbell.
I am unmuted.
Hi, Seth. We can hear you.
Awesome. Do you want to pull up that picture again of the intersection?
Sure.
It helps my mind work a little. I live at 322. You might know it as the Chicken House. I'm sorry. It's actually just above 344. So I've been here about since 94. So I'm very familiar with the intersection. We hear all the honks when people try to pull out and people get irritated that they're cutting them off. So that said, Eric, great job doing the explain the whole problem is exactly what I was thinking, in that one coming up Lafayette, no one should be taking a left anymore to go that 270 degree turn left down Greenleaf. I would suspect the number of people doing that are doing it out of habit, because the intersection down by the old Tuscan is fairly new and it's a matter of training. And I think if that wasn't even an option, they wouldn't be taking it. Making it a one way and Hillside Drive, this is the first time I'm hearing people want to go the other way. There was a petition years ago to do something with the road, and it was the older folk that are now gone that wanted the one way to go towards the hospital. They wanted a quick way to the hospital. So I think the hillside's become a little younger and people want to go towards town, which I can respect. But I also, being on a state road, every time there's a fire, there's an exchange of engines between stations. All day long, there's emergency vehicles going up and down. And I think they would probably prefer running down Greenleaf towards the bypass for emergencies. That's something to consider.
Mm-hmm. Yep, that's a good point. And unfortunately, Todd Germain, Captain Germain, or Chief Germain, had a conflict tonight and wasn't unable to attend. But he said he would watch the video and take, you know, listen to people's input. So this is, like I said, this is the first step in a process.
Absolutely. So my grand, I'll wrap it up. I've been thinking about it for what, I don't know, 26 years now, what to do. And I think the compromise would be a one-way street going down for emergency vehicles. And, you know, that's your off ramp. But the lines that are curved out, those are great when the bollards are up, but once they're off, it's business as usual. So that needs to be curved out permanently. Mm-hmm. I would say curve it out, still have the grade. I would not tee it off because of the line of sight. All you're going to do is get more accidents. And I will say, I can count the number of accidents on one hand in the 26 years I've lived there. There's rarely an accident, and never one that was that bad. There's a more honking of horns than irritability than that. The crosswalk there, and this is doable probably sooner than later, is it needs the push button flashy walk. People aren't walking across that because they aren't going to sit there and wait for traffic all day. They need the push button. And that will get people walking on the sidewalk. Right now, they're walking up the bike lane. And with the absence of bollards, I don't know why there's a lot less on Lafayette. I think we got caught up in that net of the discussion on Middle Road. Somehow it affected us on Lafayette, where the number of bollards were fine in the first year. It slowed traffic down. It was pure paradise. And then they started to disappear, and now traffic sped back up, and it's just as bad as it was. Just my observation there.
Well, thank you for your comments, Seth. Karen I'm going to butcher your name here. Solomides. Hi, Karen. You're on mute. There you go. Sorry about that. Karen, are you there? I do not hear Karen. I think I'm locked up. Peter, are you there? Can you hear me,
Peter? I can hear you, Peter.
Okay.
I can hear you.
I cannot hear Karen. We'll go to Martha Stone and maybe catch up with Karen in a second.
There you go. Hi, this is Martha. Can you hear me?
I can, yes, Martha.
Hello. Thanks for the opportunity to chime in tonight. I am the director of Crossroads House, which is down the road on Lafayette Road. And we also own a property on Greenleaf as you cross the intersection across from where Portsmouth Housing is. So I had a couple of comments tonight. One, we have a lot of our residents who stay with us are on foot or on bicycle coming to and from the shelter. So I really appreciate any kind of upgrades that have been made or will be considered in terms of pedestrian and bike traffic for safety reasons. When the state redid the intersection in front of Tuscan, that was a huge improvement, obviously. But one of the unfortunate things that happened when that intersection was done that I wanted to talk about in terms of this project tonight that you're talking about is the end of Greenleaf where it meets the bypass. At that intersection, I believe there is still a no U-turn sign. And I realize that I may be talking to the city and this may be a state issue, but I wanted to go on record that when all that work was done, we were told, I believe, that we would be able to legally make a U-turn because people who are heading northbound on Lafayette Road get to the intersection at Greenleaf. If you get in the left-hand turn lane to reverse directions to get into our parking lot at Crossroads House, it's technically illegal to make a U-turn at that point. So what we have to do is drive around to, and I know, Eric, I appreciate your email to me. I know that we can drive up by Tuscan and around by, but a lot of people coming to us are not familiar with that. Like, I know how to do that because I grew up here, but to do that big triangular loop around is a challenge. And so I just wanted to go on record to say that if that no U-turn sign, which is in the left-hand turn lane at the intersection of the bypass and Greenleaf, if that could be made legal, because there's already a green arrow signal there, that would be really helpful for people who are trying to safely access our parking lot, which is just south of the intersection that we're talking about.
Martha, we can reach out to District 6 and DOT and see if we can, in fact, show that it was supposed to be removed, mm-hmm. Or if we can get it removed. So we can reach out to them.
I appreciate that. Thank you. And then, you know, in terms of the conversation about the top of it, where you're talking about, I mean, I grew up in Portsmouth and went to Portsmouth High School, and I remember that intersection pulling out, and that sight line is really problematic. And so I think your ideas around one way are good. I've heard both directions proposed. I don't have a strong opinion about that, but one of my best friends lives across the street from that intersection. And I know, like, just the traffic getting in and out of there, it's really crazy. And it always feels risky to pull out. So I appreciate the city's effort to look at this and any kind of safety improvements that can be made. So thanks.
Good to talk to you, Martha. Thanks for your input.
Thank you. And if there's anything that I need to do to follow up with the state, if someone wants to reach out to me, I'm happy to do that just to get that, make that U-turn legal. So let me know if I can help.
Sure. We'll reach out to you if we can use your assistance. Okay.
Thank you.
Yep. Dennis Moulton. How you doing, Dennis?
Dennis Moulton. Okay, you hear me?
Hi, Dennis.
Yeah, hi, Peter. How are you doing?
I'm good, thank you.
Yeah, good. Hello, Eric and Peter. How are you doing? I guess I have kind of like a different thought on this. I agree that, you know.
I'm sorry, Dennis. Can you just state your where you live?
I live on Hillside Drive.
Okay.
Yeah, 190.
Thank you.
And so, you know, the problem, you know, and Eric mentioned the bike lanes and the striping and so forth, that does nothing at all unless there's bollards there to slow down traffic. If there's no bollards there, people fly down that curb line and they're doing 30, 40 miles an hour down Greenleaf, you know, to get to the bypass. So right away, you know, to me, there needs to be a teeing up of that intersection so that people have to slow down and actually make a turn, such as what you did over on Middle Road there, Middle Street. So that's one thing. But the other thing I'm wondering is, if we eliminated the left turn from the bypass onto Greenleaf Ave, and I know I'm going to probably make a lot of enemies on Hillside Drive here, but if we did that, that would probably eliminate a lot of people who use that as a shortcut to get from the bypass up to Lafayette Road, forcing them to go down and use the, you know, the intersection closer to the Tuscan Kitchen. Mm-hmm. Those are, you know, two of my thoughts. I'm not a big fan of turning Greenleaf into a one-way street between the two. I think it can still function as a two-way street there. The other thing is perhaps there could be a speed table installed on Greenleaf so that people who do come down in either direction won't be going very, very fast, knowing that they're going to, you know, hit that. So those are my thoughts. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, Dennis.
Thank you.
Barbara McMillan.
Thanks, Peter. Can you hear me all right?
Yeah. How you doing, Barbara?
I'm doing okay. How are you?
I'm good. Thank you.
I'm at 84 Hillside Drive, and I have a different opinion, too. So I just wanted to follow up on the U-turn intersection comment. I think that would be awesome for people on Hillside if they got rid of the no U-turn, because a lot of people then turn left and then go around Hillside when they want to change direction, which has been a historic problem ever since it's been a no U-turn. I know that's not your purview, but. And then I'm probably the only one, but I am do not like the bollards and do not like that as a slowing down technique. I don't think people slow down. What I see, and it'd be nice to document, is people coming down that road on the wrong side of the road, just constantly crossing over, going just as fast and not having enough time to move over and just being cross over the yellow line and the middle line. Just about every single car does it. So as you're coming up that, going on to Middle, you end up with, or to Lafayette, you end up, you know, having to stop or pull over or whatever to avoid people. So I really like the idea of teeing up the intersection rather than trying to do it with that flow with the bollards or some other design. And I'm kind of for coming down and making it one way, coming down Hillside. It will be a bit of a pain, but I think if you narrow the road a ton and put the crosswalk in, that idea was a good idea on my point of view. So thanks for letting us.
All right, good to hear from you, Barbara. Mike Gass.
Hello.
Hi. Oh, you got muted again.
I think you hit it while I was unmuting. I'll let you do it. There we go.
You hear me?
Hi, Mike.
Yes, we can hear you now.
All right. Hey, everybody. How you doing, Peter?
Good. How you doing, Mike?
Great. Thank you guys for allowing us for a little input. I'd love to agree with Barbara on the fact of the traffic sort of entering into the, you know, into the opposite lane coming down the hill. I kind of witness that most days, just trying to, you know, trying to take a left onto Lafayette coming out of Greenleaf. I definitely have almost been hit about a million times. I'd love some way to interrupt that flow of traffic and just slow that down. I do think I'm kind of with Greg Hebert, I think, who spoke first, and just sort of keeping our neighborhood connected to Portsmouth. I think sort of just making it one way and spilling us out into Route 1 definitely makes it feel, I don't know, more like Massachusetts to me. So I don't know. That's a, you know, that's obviously a, it's a selfish comment as somebody who lives at 120 Hillside Drive, but that's what we're here for. So, but thank you for the opportunity to speak. I appreciate it and appreciate all the work looking at the situation, because it's not an easy one to solve.
All right, Mike, thanks a lot. And we'll, just to remind everybody, you know, this is just the start of it. And we're going to, you're probably going to feel like you know, we're going to go to another public meeting. You're going to say the same thing. But it's important, you know, other people are going to participate too. And, you know, it's important to hear it all out. That's part of the public process. So we really appreciate you guys showing up and letting us know what you're thinking. Seth, you had your hand up again.
Yes, I think when we were talking the one way down from Lafayette, down Greenleaf to the bypass, in my mind, and I probably didn't clarify this, what I'm envisioning is that at the Dodge dealership light, you can still take a left into Hillside. It just, you can travel up that road and get to your house, go into Hillside or go all the way up to 5 Greenleaf, I think it is, one of the very, or 8 Greenleaf. There'll be a cul-de-sac, you know, I envision kind of a cul-de-sac where they can turn around, but it just won't dump out.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a one way for traffic, for emergency vehicles and people, because really this is the de facto on-ramp to the bypass in the area. There isn't another, unless you can name one. So everyone's forced in this area of the city to take Greenleaf Ave down to get to the bypass. That's, I see it in the morning when traffic's backed up from the high school, people are in the bike lane, really try, and if they could drive on the grass, they would, to get onto the exit ramp, and they travel at exit ramp speeds down to Greenleaf. But the access down at the bottom of the intersection, I think people can still go up there, it just won't be a through road, is what I'm envisioning anyway. So you still have access to Greenleaf both ways, mm-hmm. but for traffic, it's a one way.
Yep.
All right. And
then thinking, can you hear me still?
Yep.
Yes, we can hear you. Yep.
Okay. This is outside the box because I've had too much time to think about this.
That's good.
So the North Church Annex over on Middle Road, their big parking lot. Imagine this, another access point to the bypass. So people aren't forced down to the Greenleaf. Everyone is really, that is the only on-ramp to get down there. So if there were another, so you live on South Street and you come out to the South Street lights and you're looking at Lafayette Park to your right, you want to get on the bypass. You take a left, you go down Greenleaf. Or you go straight, take that nice new on-ramp right there on 33. I don't know how much of that land is the church's, but it wouldn't take much to put a little on-ramp there. Again, this is outside of the box thinking to try to alleviate traffic.
Yeah.
Seth, I think that's an interesting proposal. what's important, what you just said, was what I take away from it, in addition to, you know, an idea possibly being done, is managing traffic. Are there other ways to manage traffic so there's alternative routes to the bypass to reduce the amount of traffic on Greenleaf? And that's really, you know, really the thing we're wrestling with: manage the volume of traffic, manage the speeds of traffic, and how do you do that without inconveniencing the residents that are in that area significantly?
Yeah.
You know, anything that gets done on the bypass is a state issue, and I would tell you right now that I would be very surprised if they gave that idea the light of day. Because their whole goal is to limit the amount of access onto that bypass. The whole idea is to make it a straight through without having, you know, without having any people coming and going onto it, or limiting it as much as possible. So it's kind of counter to what a bypass does.
So a parkway.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, while you're at it, plant some trees in the median strip and make it look pretty. We can call it a parkway.
Sure. Well, that's, you know, we did have done a little bit of that down near the Crossroads House. But
yes,
your point is well taken, Seth.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you for entertaining.
All right. Bernice, you have your hand up again. Eric, you doing it or am I?
Nope, I thought you were.
No, I held off.
All right. Thank you. You know, I was thinking, what Seth was thinking, is that if we could somehow keep Greenleaf, like I'm on three Hillside Drive, so I'm the corner house on the first, on the north side of Hillside. And it's true, getting out of that is kind of like, you know, suddenly I see a car right behind me when I didn't see a car 2 minutes when I made the turn. But if we could keep, and I don't know how this impacts people north of me on Greenleaf actually, but if we could keep it like two ways so that we could get to our houses from the bypass, but yet only one way to access it from Greenleaf. So you take away that from Lafayette to Greenleaf, right? So it's one way, Lafayette to Greenleaf, but yet two way so that people can get to their homes from the bypass.
Yeah, well, that's something that we've thought about as well. And I think that's, you know, it deserves further consideration.
Okay.
How we could execute something like that.
Yep.
Yeah, I just want to get my PG out of my driveway.
Thank you.
Yep. Kristen Robertson, you haven't had a chance to speak.
There you go. Can you hear me okay now?
Yep.
Yes, we can.
Great. So I own 420 Lafayette, which is actually getting in and out of my driveway. I take my life in my own hands like every time, because I'm rut like at the second intersection of Hillside, rut as that hill's coming down. So I think in the picture you showed at the street level, that's my house that you can see. So literally, yeah. So speed is definitely an issue. I want to just resonate that. I think you've heard that all night long. I also, when I heard about potentially looking at traffic flow, I agree with Seth and the last person who spoke that potentially just doing one way from the top from Lafayette Road just down, but still having the rest of it two way would probably make it more accessible for us getting to our homes. My concern with the location of my house in particular is, you know, huge change in the traffic pattern if that sort of approach is made, and where will people turn around and will it be in my driveway because it's right there? So I think that's something to consider, but anything we can do to slow people down both ways, speed is a huge problem in this cut through.
Okay. Thank you very much. Greg Hebert.
Okay, thank you. A follow-up, and I don't know if it's which of you, I think it's for Eric, but I'm not sure. When that intersection that I think we've been sort of calling it the Tuscan Market intersection down there, but when that was redesigned, was the purpose to make that the workhorse for the area? Because when, again, I'm on 183 Hillside, when I look at the Greenleaf bypass intersection versus the Lafayette Road bypass intersection, those are of entirely different scales of turning lanes and light control and all those kinds of things. You have what is essentially a low speed neighborhood outlet into there versus a heavy duty intersection over there. Was the intent to move traffic to the bypass through there? I think people are saying historically Greenleaf was an access route to the bypass, but it doesn't seem that it's built in the same level that Lafayette Road is.
The answer is yes. I mean, okay. It was intended, and that in conjunction with Andrew Jarvis intersection, or the traffic signal we put there, was really intended to allow and facilitate traffic to utilize that Tuscan, you know, it'll be always known now as the Tuscan, as opposed to, what was it, the Jerry Lewis? Was that the theater before that. So the hope was that we could this would allow us to facilitate some change on Greenleaf.
Okay, because I want to make my point. He has to be connected, and I think we've heard a lot of different good ideas. I think everybody should rightly be speaking about what their, you know, what their personal experience is to help inform a best decision. But I guess I come back to it doesn't seem like traffic flow from Lafayette down Greenleaf to the bypass is ever going to be properly slowed, and it seems speed is a issue for lots of people. And it's like, well, if there's a way to slow people down, then maybe that's successful. But even to the point where I think we've had a couple of people say that they're using the whole road, both sides coming down Greenleaf, so they don't have to slow down while they go around the blockage there. So I'm still a proponent of not having people come down that way, but if there's a way to slow all the traffic at that tough angle intersection, if there's space for whatever the best traffic device is, that may alleviate that and encourage people to use the Lewis. Okay, we'll try and get back to the Lewis intersection down below, which was designed for the heavy usage. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and that, I mean, that's, so there's some reoccurring themes here that, you know, that we're coming across. It's like, you know, slow traffic, keep connectivity to downtown, keep connectivity to the community, and managing the volume of traffic. So these are reoccurring themes, which is, it's good when we go to do the design, see if we can hit those, you know, those goals. Now, I still see Karen Solomides, hand up, but she is not speaking.
I think she's got a problem trying to unmute.
Karen, are you there?
Looks like she's unmuted, Peter.
Yeah. Hi, Karen, you there? It must be incredibly frustrating if you are trying to speak at the moment. Well, let's go to Don Pexton next, because he has not spoken yet. And Seth, we can come back to you in a second. Hi, Don.
Oh, Don needs to unmute.
Don, you can speak if you unmute. All right, well, Don. So Eric, we have Stephanie Secord's hand up. Stephanie, would you like to?
Okay, just a quick note. Aaron is communicating in the chat.
Ah, I'm not managing the chat at the moment. I can only, I'm a limited in terms of.
Peter, I could read her comment. So it's from Karen.
That'd be great.
Minus to panelists and attendees. Would it be possible to keep Greenleaf open to local traffic only? So I'm assuming she's meaning some sort of signage or something that you'd put up there.
There are challenges with posting something like that because it's a public road, and you know, how do you define local? I live in Portsmouth, but I live on, you know, the other end of town. I'm local. So it could be a challenge from, you know, just an equity standpoint. People pay taxes and feel they have a right to use the roads that are paid for. But it is something that, you know, again, it's managing the volume of traffic. So that's a similar comment, but it's, you know, we can note that and just say, you know, definitely check it to make sure it's not something we can potentially do. Don, have you, I guess I should look at the chat. Is that Don?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes, yeah. I can hear you. Don.
I've been fighting this Zoom thing, but I guess I'll have to give it a try. I'm at 225 Hillside Drive. I'm definitely in favor of keeping the traffic both ways. My thought is to, I guess people have talked about it as a, like a T-interception, T intersection. Make it very similar to the changes made at the intersection of Spinney and Islington. Kind of in, you know, very, you know, it used to be a whip down and take an easy right to head down towards Pick and Pay, but they made it a much tougher angle, more of a 90 degree angle. And that would be kind of a reverse way at the intersection of Greenleaf and Hillside. Mm-hmm. That would be my thought. I'm definitely in favor of not making it one way, keeping it just the way it is, connecting with Portsmouth the whole way. I think there's room enough to do that with getting rid of those lilacs and, you know, putting in some curbing, still having it wide enough so that if emergency vehicles needed to come down, they could. But kind of force people to almost make a coming up towards Lafayette, make a little bit of a right turn, so you're kind of at a 90 degree angle before you make your left. That's my thought process. And thank you.
All right.
Thanks,
all right. Don. Thank you, Don. Yeah. And Seth's.
Just to follow up on Don, the teeing it off. I did see PDFs early on in the project phase of the new intersection at the Tuscan Jerry Lewis intersection. They actually had plans to tee that off with a light. And if they did tee it off because of the grading there, it would have to be a lighted intersection for safety. I'm telling you, people would get T-bone there. And the number of accidents on one hand that I've seen in 26 years would go up. Because they're close accidents now, but I think at the T, people pulling out and the speeds people are going on Lafayette, there's not going to be enough time. So it would have to be a lighted intersection if that were to be entertained. But at that state level, they have PDFs somewhere that actually have that all planned out.
Yep. The challenge with signalized intersections, you know, so close together is you run into traffic queuing up on top of each other.
I'm not a fan. I have to look at that light. I don't want it. No. I'm the one way down to the bypass guy.
at one point years ago, there was a move to take Andrew Jarvis and connect it straight through.
Yeah, you told me that once.
Yeah, and eliminate the Greenleaf entrance up top. And that, unfortunately, you know, that just never came to fruition. Because it would involve taking a building and a property or purchasing a property.
Yeah. And but, at that time, it would have been cents on the dollar.
Yeah. Foresight, right? If we were all smart, we would have bought tons of property.
That's too bad that didn't happen, but.
I'm not seeing anybody else's hand up at the moment.
Jesse,
I was just going to suggest, Peter, if people have email comments they want to send in or anything.
Yeah, I was gonna have Eric give his email. Actually, I see Charlie Griffin's hand up at the moment, so let's allow Charlie to.
Can you hear me, Peter?
We can.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. My name is Charlie Griffin. My wife and I live at 210 Hillside Drive. We've lived here for 43 years as of June 1st of this year. I also grew up on Hillside Drive. Let me suggest some milder improvements. First thing I noticed that I would suggest moving the 20 mile per hour speed limit sign farther up towards the intersection of Greenleaf. There's a sign there which says, I think, no through truck traffic, maybe append it to that, so that people approaching Greenleaf are aware earlier on that the speed limit is only 20 miles an hour. It's too far down now and it's behind a tree. So it's hard to pick up until you're part of the way down Greenleaf. Maybe also putting some blind intersection signs at the intersection of Hillside and Greenleaf. There's a tree at the intersection of Hillside and Greenleaf as you come out the first entrance. I don't know whether that's on private property or not, but that obscures vision substantially. Maybe putting speed bumps onto Greenleaf as well. And I agree with the earlier comment about signalizing the intersection of the crosswalk at Greenleaf and Lafayette as been done by the high school. My wife and I are part of the older generation, so I'm very concerned with keeping Greenleaf open
both ways, or at least so that emergency responders can get down to Greenleaf onto Hillside, because I've actually driven it both ways. And I can tell you, if you have to go down Lafayette onto the bypass and back into Greenleaf and Hillside, it takes twice as long to do that as it does if you can simply go straight down a Greenleaf. And we do have a number of, while Hillside has rejuvenated itself, which is great, there are a number of us senior citizens still there whose concerns are, can the ambulance get here on time and get me to the hospital on time? And so I'd want to make sure that we can have a clear shot onto the down Greenleaf and from Greenleaf onto the bypass, and so that a first responder can get to the hospital. Thank you very much.
All right, thanks, Charlie. Yeah. All right, so Eric, you want to, can you state your email address?
Sure, I don't have it on the screen, but it is EBEBY, so it's five letters. My first two initials and last name, EBEBY at cityofportsmouth.com. Again, it's EBEBY at cityofportsmouth.com. And I may have been on the notice that we sent out to everybody too for the meeting, but and it was in the Zoom registrations, I think you can get it as well. So it's EBEBY at cityofportsmouth.com.
That's all right, it. I see. Oh, good. There you go. Awesome. Thanks, Seth. And then I see in the comments that that the tree has been requested to be removed before. It wasn't approved for some reason. So we can revisit that with the Tree and Greenery Committee. Speed bumps are noisy, somebody had said. And the 20 mile an hour side, that's something that we should look at immediately. I think that's a good suggestion. We can move that up. We don't have to wait for anything on that. And the tree, I agree that tree at least needs to be limbed back or trimmed so that you can see better. But it is a side obstruction.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, I'm not seeing anybody else's hand up at the moment. But as I, you know, as we've said, this is really the first step in a process that, you know, hopefully we can come to the end of this process and everybody's going to be happy. There are balances that have to be struck with these challenges, and that, you know, we try to take into consideration everybody's concerns, and at times we're not able to accommodate everybody, but we will strive to do that. And so the next step will be for us to go forward with selecting a consultant to work with us to develop the design, and that'll have a public process with it, and that'll, you know, likely be out sometime towards the end of the summer. So we would anticipate something in the fall in terms of starting up something more concerted. There is funding for the design aspect of this, but there is not enough funding for the complete construction. So what we typically do is we do the design and we get a feel for what the cost is, and then we revise our CIP or capital improvement plan request to City Council once that's firmed up. So, you know, really at this point, we're going to be looking to get a consultant on board and start the design process. And, you know, please feel free to reach out to us. And, you know, it's a good opportunity for everybody. And the information we got tonight was great. We got some really good feedback. And I'm not sure if there's anything else, Eric, you would like to add, or Chairman, or Councillor Whalen?
No, I think we're all set, Peter. And I appreciate all the residents who came out tonight. We had over 26 residents, so that's fantastic. So it's a great start. So we look forward to it.
Yeah, it's awesome. Yep. I really, really appreciate everybody's time.
Yep. Thank you, everybody.
All right. Well, with that, we will turn off the recording and call it an evening.
All right. In time for the Bruins game.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.